I think basically Dr. Umar must have asked for the elders to sit down with all of them and have a discussion about what they want to do going forward. He was saying, I don't want to speak to no damn elders. What am I talking to the elders for?
Who are the elders?
I don't know. It's elders in the Pan-Africanism. He didn't mention names. He just said the elders, so people should know.
Okay.
Right? So it's not Uncle Tunde from Beckham. So he could go there. I don't know. He might just turn up, man. If man's calling for hours and not telling you who you are, he might just turn up.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, cats and dogs, rodents and other small insects. Welcome to another episode of Eloquently Saying Nothing, a new season of Eloquently Saying Nothing. This is episode one of season two. This is Stavros, boss. I am back in the house as well as all the rest of the boys. Let's go around, introduce ourselves and then tell you what this podcast is about and then we'll move forward. Yes. Who's next?
Wahala's in the building. What happened to your big intro about how you're General Zod and all that thing from last time?
You mans didn't like it, so left it out.
Yeah, I'm Wahala, people. Blessings be. Welcome back.
Kneel before Zod. This is Mr. Wolf in the building. Happy to be back. And, bald head like Colt Jack.
Simple Simon is in the building. Yes, I'm in the place. It's above your knee and below your waist. Yes, that's me.
Season's greetings, the sperms is freezing. It's the Black Parker touching your girl while she's sneezing.
Why when she's sneezing?
Because she doesn't realise the difference. Isn't it? She just doesn't.
Because when you sneeze, you die.
Rape culture. Man went straight into touching a woman because she doesn't know.
She's tense at that time, isn't it? When you sneeze,
oh, yeah, it's not even
then
funny.
You feel the firmness.
Alright, before we go down that road, I don't know why I highlighted that.
Anyway, I'm looking at Wahala, I'm like, no, bro, no.
Before we go down that road, let's just introduce the podcast itself. This podcast is called Eloquently Saying Nothing. For sure, it's ESN. It's a bunch of guys that got together a few years ago and just decided we're going to record something and discuss. Yes,
Webs. Why did you get cockney when you said nothing?
I don't know, because I'm an East Londoner.
Why did you put up your hand like we're in school?
Because if I interrupted, I would have got told off.
I like that way of thinking, yes. We got together, we started recording the podcast. We did it for about 2 or 3 years, I can't even remember, and we took a hiatus about 4 years ago, well, 4+ years ago, and now we're back with season two because the public want it. Podcasts are all blowing up now. We were early, and now we're late. So we are here, and we're going to discuss stuff with life. So does anybody want to talk about what they did whilst we've been away, or do we just get straight into just talking about current topics and what we want to discuss?
I want to talk about Wahala's t-shirt.
All right, go for it.
Original Eba eater, it says.
Man. Eba?
Oh, yeah, tell us now.
What's to tell you? It's original Eba eater now. What do you want me to tell you?
Tell us the background behind it, man.
Oh, I don't know. I made this t-shirt in about 2000. I don't even know what year it was, Steph. What year was it that we had this?
I don't think it was that. What was it? What birthday was it for?
I don't know. One of your birthdays, isn't it?
It was before 30.
No. Is that what I'm saying? Yeah, it was definitely before 30. I can't remember. Which woman were you going out with at the time? I wasn't going out.
That is a good way to gauge my life.
It's a good indication, yeah.
At this point, I wasn't going out with anyone. So this is between 25 and...
Was that t-shirt around at one of the F&F events?
I don't even know what F&F,
Friends and Family.
No. I got this. I was wearing this at AGS. It was at AGS. I think it was maybe your 25th, 26th, you know.
Nah,
it was that long. It was about 2002, 2003, I reckon.
Wow.
I reckon, maybe 2004. Anyway, this was the time when us mans, when we went out, we just used to have custom-made t-shirts every single time we went out. Well, me and Stav, anyway, we just used to customize our t-shirts every time we went out. So, I don't know. I just wanted to have an original Eba.
No. This was when I did the party. Well, because I was known for wearing custom clothing, and that birthday I decided everybody must wear something custom.
Did they?
Yes. People must wear something custom. So they either have to design it and print it online or stitch something on their own clothing, And that was the premise of the party. And enough people came. Remember, Andy came with his Andy and his cousins came, and they had their stuff printed on their t-shirts with me on it.
Oh yeah! Shout out to Rana, man.
You came with that. Yeah, there's people that came with my face printed on their clothes.
I don't know what possessed any human being to do that.
Can you imagine? Yeah.
But the fact that t-shirt is very old, yeah, and it still looks good.
Hi, you welcome to the party. What are you wearing?
Because it was a one-time thing. You wear it once, you just put in the wood up, and that's it.
Well, you don't wear it as home clothes then?
Well, I now wear it as home clothes. Mm. As you can see, I'm in the home. But yeah, it was just those days, we never used to wear the same thing twice. We had money, even though we had no money. That's how it was, isn't it? It was privileged. Them days where you live in your parents' house.
You know what, you're right. It was before Facebook, actually.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. It was a long time ago, man.
Because yeah, I was thinking, because I remember later on, uploading it to Facebook, not at the time.
You know, you just lost half the audience, like, before Facebook.
You're old.
What was before Facebook?
I'm not even that old. I'm old, but I'm not that old. I'm old in spirit more than I am in actual age.
Was MySpace blowing up?
Yeah, MySpace might have been blowing up these times, man.
Yeah.
You can diss MySpace all they want. That guy's got 500 million.
Have you, Dirty? Though, have you?
He took the 500 million and ran with it. And I'm sure he's part of another company. In fact, he's part of Facebook, isn't he?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, I think he's part of the original. If you go by the film, he was one of the people that was involved in Facebook. Because remember, I think he was played by Justin Timberlake in the film.
No, that was the Napster guy.
Yeah.
Was the Napster guy?
Yeah, he was the Napster guy.
Oh, okay.
But coincidentally, Justin Timberlake owns shares in MySpace now.
Does he?
He's one of the, like, I think he's a majority shareholder.
Basically. In MySpace?
Yes.
What possessed him to do that?
Who knows? He was trying to ting in it.
And MySpace is still going strong, is it?
It's there.
It's there. It's not about it's still going strong, but it's there.
Nobody uses it, do they?
Mm. I think people might use it. I think actual people might use it for a different
purpose.
Does
anybody actually remember their MySpace password?
Yes.
Of course I do.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah. I've got two tune up there still.
Two tune.
I never had a... Sibyl Simon never had a MySpace.
Boy.
Oh. Belial.
Did you have Black Chat?
Which one was Black Chat again?
Which one's the one where everybody...
Black Chat was the chat room.
And High Five.
I had High Five.
I never had High Five.
I had a High Five.
I had a Black Chat.
But Black Chat was the one that everyone was just like...
Trying to draw girls, yes.
Not trying.
I used to link girls on that thing. That was good time.
That was before Tinder, mate. Before Tinder, that was the original.
Black Chat. You didn't swipe on that.
Two lyrics on there, ASL, you get me.
What's ASL?
Age, sex, location.
Wow.
Get me.
Yeah, man.
One time.
I don't even know about these things. I was young.
Yeah, man.
I was young.
As soon as I hit uni, that was the first thing. Yeah, for real.
Snapchat me. Anyway, all right. And so that's the t-shirt out of the way and old school social networks. Let's go to Wahala. You wanted to talk about Dr. Umar Johnson versus General Seti.
Oh, my days. Oh, my God.
There's something going on about this. What's going on?
So I don't really know the ins and outs of the conscious community. That's what I'm going to call them at the moment. They call themselves the conscious community.
My wife was calling them
Hotep. Yeah, or you want to? What else do they call themselves these days? What's the other one, man?
Here come the Hotep.
Anyway, I can't remember the last.
Who is Mr. Umar,
the Pro Black Movement?
Yeah, who is he?
What's his
background?
He calls himself the Prince of
Pro Blackness.
No, not Pro Blackness. It's a particular term, man.
Affirmative action.
No, man, you one of you lot should know the term I was talking about.
You're the one that's been watching the video for the past.
Conscious living.
No, not consciousness. The Prince of what's the? Oh man, no.
Pussy.
Darkness?
No, it's not Afrocentric or something. It's the other one. I'm looking at you, Simple. It doesn't matter, man.
It matters.
Pan-African culture.
That's it. Yeah. That's it. Yeah, so he calls himself the Prince of Pro-African,
Pan-African
movement, yeah? So he's basically a guy that does a lot of... he's basically a black activist, but more of a social media type, YouTube type, book selling type, I've been published type. Trying to build a school for 15 years type person.
You know, he said tripe, a couple of those types.
Sharky. But anyway, so he's online a lot. He does a lot of videos, a lot of positive speaking, goes to a lot of black areas and talks to the public about what he feels needs to happen for the black men and women to, better themselves and such. A lot of people look up to him. A lot of other people look at him as a fraudster that's out for, money. A bit like our, favourite guy. What's his name? Not your favourite guy, not Mr. Man and the other one.
Creflo
Dollar. Yeah, like Mr. Creflo. Yeah, so he's a bit like him. He's quite well known. As I said, he calls himself the Prince of Pan-Africanism. He's probably, at the moment, probably one of the most well-known people that represents Pan-Africanism into the public. Not necessarily one of the ones that is the best, obviously, but he's just quite well
known. I would hazard a guess that he's the most well-known at the moment.
Mm. So, yeah. So, basically, there's another one called General Seti.
Seti.
Who also believes himself to be a part of the conscious movement and believes to be one of the original, he calls himself conscious brothers. He didn't necessarily use the word brothers, but I don't use the word that they use all over the place.
So these guys are all about the upliftment
of the black folk.
I'm glad you put it that way.
Right. Yeah, so they're supposed to be about the upliftment of black people. Mm-hmm. But at the moment, online, they're going out on an all-out war. So General Zeti must have said that, you know, he's the first to do all of this stuff and all these other brothers are moving in his footsteps. And then he basically slung some shots at Dr. Umar Johnson, called him a big diss, some other stuff that, called him the N-word a good couple of times. Some indirect, some direct attacks on him. And said, I think basically Dr. Umar must have asked for the elders to sit down with all of them and have a discussion about what they want to do going forward. He was saying, I don't want to speak to no damn elders. What am I talking to the elders for?
Who are the elders?
I don't know. It's elders in the Pan-Africanism. He didn't mention names. He just said the elders. So people should know.
Okay.
Right. So it's not Uncle Tunde from Beckham. So he could go there. I don't know.
From Beckham.
He might just turn up, man. If man's calling for elders and not telling you who you are, he might just turn up. Expecting food as well, innit?
One shiny shoe.
Expecting food and drink.
Okay, I'm here to discuss. Do you have food for us before we get started?
I eat before we talk.
So basically, he sent out that video, and then Dr. Umar Johnson decided that he was going to go on a 45-minute rant.
Rant.
45-minute rant.
Please tell me you didn't listen to the whole
thing. I listened to every last second of it. I enjoyed every last second of it.
People have time.
Oh, you know, I had time for
that. I don't understand how you people have the time to sit there and watch that 45. If it's not Pastor King.
Yeah, Manning. Yeah, that you were
David James Manning. Why are you watching a 45-minute video of a man running?
I couldn't believe. Listen, for me, this is better than Ifa. It's better than Hit 'Em Up. It's better than most of them hip hop tunes that came out that was scathing, apparently, to the other person. That's how much I enjoyed Dr. Umar Johnson's rant. Because he went from starting off saying, big up to, you know, my black people and the black community. That's how he started.
It was really calm.
Peace be to y'all.
Peace be y'all to the black community and black people. To suddenly start calling everybody under the sun the N-word. And this went on a crazy rant. Crazy rant. So yeah, I just want to. I know the rest of the guys have heard heard it. I'm hoping that some of the guys that's listening to us now has heard it outside in the open world. But I just want to discuss what you think about these two guys that's meant to be on the upliftment of black people beefing.
All right, Simple Simon. I've heard of Dr. Umar Johnson because of a DVD series called Hidden Colors.
Yes.
They got a 1, 2, and 3 on there. I'm not sure that he's responsible for the content, but he features quite heavily in it. So I became aware of him because of this. And he does, I've listened to like a couple of bits and pieces of his talks and stuff like that. And he does on the surface appear to be a beacon of positivity within the African community. I also heard that there was some kind of controversy about some stripper or something.
Oh yeah, he apparently in the past slept with some stripper, and
yes,
which I don't think is much of a big deal, to be honest.
Sleep with the stripper, yes.
I don't think there's anything. No, but to be honest, that is
Mr.
one.
Mr. Wolf said yes.
No, with the stripper thing, it annoys me a bit that people were upset. Because for me, if you're meant to be in the upliftment of black people, yeah, that includes
getting up in their black bosom.
No, no, no. 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 No.
I'm going to lift up that black skirt.
No.
And
no.
Uplift.
There's just something wrong with you.
Listen, calm down. But anyway, oh yeah, so for me, I think it's not a bad thing. if he went out of his way, you know, to actually date this woman.
I'm
just saying, if he did. I know he was pursuing her because he was calling them. What he didn't just you know, tried to enter and left her alone. He was calling her. That's why she got all these messages from him trying to chat to her. So if he was trying to go out of his way to, you know, bring her away from the stripping and to be more of what he thinks is a positive black woman in his society.
Hello, lady. I'd like to bring you away from the stripping and make you a more positive role model in this society. Exactly. Stand by my side.
I don't see anything wrong with that. I don't see a problem with him sleeping with strippers. Are we saying that he should now discard all strippers? Are we not following the way of Jesus and moving with the people them that was the criminals?
What I'm saying, though, yeah. What I'm saying.
You referred
to a stripper, a criminal.
Hang on. Are you referring to her in the same light as Mary Magdalene?
No, I'm not saying about Mary Magdalene. No, Jesus walked through the criminals, didn't he? He went to go and
Mary was a stripper. Prostitute.
She was a whore, but...
Not of Babylon.
But she was a righteous whore. So, we've got time for Mary Magdalene. Let's not talk on Mary like
that. Before I deal with your penis, let us pray.
No, that's gone too far. No, but so yeah, he had the stripper controversy. I didn't think there was anything wrong with him sleeping with strippers, but I don't agree with your explanation that he's allowed to do it as some part of upliftment.
No, program. I'm not saying he's doing that as an upliftment
program. Right now you're stripping. Let me give you some of this probat penis, and it will change your mind.
That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that he shouldn't be saying, because people are saying, how can you be sleeping with a stripper? How can you be trying to deal with a stripper? And I'm thinking, she's a human being the same way like everyone else is. He might not agree with her way of life, and he should be going out of his way to try and say, you know, that's not really the way of life you should be living. But I don't think that he should be discarding her as a human being because she's a stripper. That's my personal opinion.
No, he shouldn't discard her as a human being. But then we have to get into context of things. How did he meet the stripper? Did he meet her at work?
No, I think he met her at one of his, like, rally things.
At one of the rallies?
Yeah, okay, I think so she went out there and where?
She was trying to come up out of the... Well, she's trying to feed her mind, yeah? Okay. We can say she's trying to feed her mind.
If she was there. That's why I believe that.
Either way, he met black a woman that he took a fancy to. He had sex outside of marriage, which if it's important to him or not. And then it came to pass. Maybe he knew before or after. It doesn't matter that she was a stripper. And then it got out there in the big wide world, and then people chastised him for it because you're Mr. Black Righteous Man, you shouldn't be having sex with strippers. But this is a new subject. So what happened after all this?
No, so as far as I know, this is what I know of him so far. This 45-minute rant video, I'll be honest with you, I got less than 5 minutes into it. I was immediately put off the moment he started using the N-bomb all over the place.
This is nonsense.
And as soon as I heard that, I thought to myself, you're presenting me with a contradiction of terms, because you're talking about kings and queens and us being greater than and what have you, and then you're going to spend 45 minutes or however. Well, I saw, like I said, within the first 5 minutes, he said it so many times that I was like, this is ridiculous. We used to cuss J. Cole for saying the N-word on his songs too much. Mm-hmm. He said N-word in those 5 minutes more than J. Cole says on a whole song. And I said, you know what? I can't really sit here and listen to this anymore. I don't even care if he's talking some truth in what he's saying here. I'm not going to sit down here and listen to him.
Yeah, Wahala. Yeah, Mr. I don't like J. Cole saying the N-word so much, but I'm going to listen to 45 minutes of Dr. Umar saying the N-word.
Listen. J. Cole's not as real as Dr. Umar. Dr. Umar's out in these streets, bruv. He's out in these streets calling people the N-word.
He's out in the streets. He's in the strip clubs. Everywhere.
So I'm when I heard that, it kind of put me off. So I didn't even bother to watch the rest of the video. But from what I've heard, there's all types of hilarity that occurs in there, like answering phones that didn't really ring, and then they ring when he's answering them, and all kinds of crazy stuff. So yeah,
the phone rang. He pressed the button to silence it
twice.
Then for some reason, like 2 seconds after he had silenced it, he picked up his phone and said, "What is it? I got this, man.
I got this.
And then the phone ringed while she was talking on the phone.
And then he silenced it again
and put it down.
I want it to be known that the ringtone that was playing was Chris Brown, "These Hoes Ain't Love."
And this is supposed to be the conscious leader of the upliftment.
Yes, but in his version, you know, how he interprets the song, the hoes are the Caucasians of society, and they're not loyal to the people that we, you know, us people.
Listen, to me, I don't really follow back a man and them kind of thing there. So I'm not following no man still. And I will take your word at face value until otherwise known.
With the Dr. Umar Johnson, he talked a lot of truth. He did, he presented the research into a lot of the psychological problems that we have in the African community. He talked about, in detail, the systemic problems we have within the societies we live in, Western societies and what have you. And he said a lot of truth and all the rest of it. So if I'm dealing with what he's saying, he is talking some truth. I can't look at the liberty of the man and put it on what he's saying. But equally, it's difficult to swallow the truth when it's coming out of somebody who's...
put their mouth on a stripper.
Well, you know, like somebody who's done less in their own personal representation than I think would be necessary. Like, I think it would be fair to say that he's supposed to be a role model, right?
Yeah, well, he is supposed to be a role model. He's been telling people how they should be living their life for years.
Did you call him a road model?
Yeah, that's a new one out there. Road model, fam.
Yeah,
road model.
Trust me.
I'm just trying to do my thing in it. I'm a road model.
Should we not, you know, look at the good things that he's done?
No, I'm not taking away from him.
He's done more good than
I'm not taking away from him. I'm not taking away from the. Yeah, I hear you, but I'm not taking away from the good that he's done. But my thing is this, yeah. If you are talking about this. Let's take it back to the really, really simple thing. Let's look at young, impressionable minds, yeah? Let's look at the youth out there that are on the crossroads of picking up a gun and shooting somebody or selling crack or listening to this man. Let's talk about those people that are on the knife edge, yeah? It's very difficult to stop somebody from doing those things. They need consistency. They need to hear the message. They need to understand the message they're being told, and then they need to see the consistency of it in liberty.
Mm-hmm.
He has delivered the message consistently, but we are seeing that his liberty does not match the message. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? No, like, even if we take away the stripper thing, let's leave that alone. This man had a 45-minute rant calling another black person the N-word. When you can see in his seminars, he talks about us being brainwashed into calling each other that word. It's not even a word that's in our dictionary. It's not even a word. It doesn't mean anything. The white man purposely made it or what have you, and you're calling it each other in the songs. I've heard him say that in his seminars.
He's actually said that.
Yeah, and then he's going to spend 45 minutes saying it to somebody else.
Can I interject and slightly talk hypocritical about the word Negro, nigger, and the term negus? Anyone heard of that?
I'm not dealing with that foolishness.
I'm just throwing the curveball in there. Hold on. The reason why I'm saying that is I didn't know that
negus is Amharic.
Right, so my thing is that
Explain it for anyone that doesn't understand what you're on about.
I don't know
so
wholeheartedly what the word means, but what I do know is that there are some people who are of the impression that the word nigger is not a derogatory term.
They're fools.
No. No. What's happening here, right, is we have a major problem, and I'm sorry to say it, but it's African-American community. They're the one that want to hold on to this word so
love
badly.
Love it so much, like so it's their badly. Child.
So in doing that, they will find as many different angles and diversity for why it should be a legitimized word that could be so part of the lexicon.
And it's usually because... I'm going to say this rule, yeah? Right? As a person that used to spit bars back in the day when I was still fresh like that, right? That word is so easy to rhyme with so much things. If that's why so many people use it in hip-hop, you'd be shocked how easy it is to slip that word in to rhyme.
This is why Eminem's so good, because he can't use it, so he had to figure it out.
I read something the other day saying he used it once and removed it. And it was going on to say it was such a good thing that he took it away. Like, he removed it. But anyway, that's another thing about that. But yeah, so the N-word gets put into the song so easily because it's so easy to rhyme with other words.
True.
Like, a lot of words rhyme with it.
True.
And it's a filler word. That's why J. Cole uses it so much. That's why I don't really rate him as much as everybody else does, because I know he uses it as a filler. But yeah, so I think they're definitely always going to keep it. But as my guy Simple said right about now, yeah, the Americans obsessed with that word because it's so ingrained into their culture and to what they have in the day-to-day living. It's like they would never get rid of it. It will always be there. So they're just trying to find a way to claim it back, as they call it. And this niggas thing just popped up. And it's a foolishness.
Niggas, don't get me wrong, niggas is a legitimate term. It's Amharic, which is from the Ethiopian side of Africa. And it basically means, in poor translation, king.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, it means it's king or head of royalty kind of thing, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And yes, the word standalone niggas is there. But if you look at the etymology of the word nigger, there is no niggas in there. The etymology of the word goes back to Latin, which is negre, yeah? And then it goes to Spanish, which is negra.
Negra, yeah.
And then negra, then it's negro, and then the white man came along and said nigger, which is completely nothing to do with, do you understand what I'm saying to you? And it's a completely...
Well, he called me nigger. Because I called him nigger.
All those previous terms meant...
Men black.
Yeah, Spanish black. Term, but when, Latin and Italian yeah, and Roman men black. Is
yeah.
black.
Yeah. Yeah. But once it was changed to nigger...
It became free-faced human. Yeah,
it was a derogatory term used against black people.
Because these people speak English, and yes. English has the word black.
So now you've got this Dr. Umar Johnson, who is for the upliftment of black people.
Before we move back onto that, because I've got an issue with them trying to reclaim, or people trying to reclaim this word, because you can't reclaim a word. A word is a word, and that's what it is. So I don't get why, because you have the gay community, they want to reclaim queer, because queer was, it meant one thing, and then it was used derogatorily, because queer is basically like a bit strange, isn't it? It means strange. Then it was used against gay people because, in a derogatory manner. Because
stop. Sorry, I don't mean to, but let me cut you there.
Go ahead.
They reclaimed the word gay because you're even using it to mean homosexual, and gay means happy.
Happy.
Okay.
Always has.
But gay community.
I'm happy. Gay are you?
Homo.
I don't think gay was reclaimed. Sexual. I just think that it made, there was another, it splintered off into another word, because that has, there are words that mean two different things. In fact, many words mean two different things. So I just think gay is one of those words.
No, homosexuality got added to gay later in its history.
Yes, but that happens often. It's not nobody tried to reclaim the word. You can use gay in the old-fashioned term. Nobody does it anymore because that's the word as, yes, in the general consensus and in mass society, gay no longer means happy.
Okay, so then gay
now means homosexual.
So then by that, by that same argument, could then Dr. Umar Johnson not say that we can reclaim, or we can...
It's not being reclaimed, though.
Okay, so the word, so we can say that the term nigger now doesn't mean the derogatory stuff it meant before. It means like brother or kinfolk.
Well, the way Dr. Umar Johnson is speaking, he's not speaking of any kind of, you know, niceties.
Yeah, he's not using
very aggressive.
Yeah, he's not using it in a positive manner. And for two, gay means two different things. It's not that, oh, let's take gay and eradicate what it means before, and now it means this, which is what you're saying with nigger. Yeah, you're saying nigger no longer means this.
But they are saying that, though. Some people are saying that nigger now means my brother. Nigger now means my friend.
No, but I'm saying, no. Because
people even say there's a difference between nigger and my nigger. Like, that is two different things.
Simple Simon was saying that, was comparing the gay word with nigger.
I don't even like using the word on the podcast.
Yeah, I know it's leave it to I, but we're using it in context.
Nigger.
Yes, so... gay means two different things.
Okay.
And they're saying that they want the word nigger to stop meaning one thing and to start meaning this. And I'm saying that I don't see that as
I don't understand Americans and their obsession with this word. It upsets me. But let's go back to Dr. Umar.
Yes, Mr. Wolf, please continue.
No, I was just saying that this is a man who is of the upliftment of black people.
Supposedly,
and he's using this term in a very negative manner. I am one who always looks at, or always tries to look at the positives in people and look at the good things that they've done. And maybe he's just, you know, maybe his buttons have been pushed and he got upset on this one moment. Is this something that is commonplace?
Yeah, but when you say his buttons have been pushed, you mean like R. Kelly button push, where you just piss on a child? Is that what you mean? Like,
that's a completely different
picture. Why are we going to R. Kelly for?
No, because I'm just saying, like, you're saying you want to just look at the good that people do, which is fine, but let's call it where it is, isn't it? Sometimes people do effed up shit. This is effed up shit.
I don't know how that analogy matches, but anyway, with regards to your saying about the fact that he wanted to do something that, you know, he got his buttons pushed, as far as I'm concerned, you're getting your buttons pushed. What you do, you react strongly straight away, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
You don't then say, I'm going to wait an hour on end and I'm going to make a video to 45 minutes.
I'm not making excuses for the guy.
You know what I mean? He took it out of his time to go and make a video.
And even if he did that video in vexation, there's a 45 minute long video, yeah? Let's say that in that 45 minutes, he calmed down a little bit. When the video finished, why did he then push upload?
Maybe he did it live.
Or maybe he did it live.
For me personally, I'm not impressed with what he did. I have never really been super impressed with how he. I think he's intelligent, and I think he's well versed on history, and he's articulate in the way he puts it across. But there's always been something that hasn't resonated with me personally. Stavros hasn't really resonated with me, so that's cool. But that's cool. I had no issues against him with the stripper thing. It wasn't a massive issue for me either. But this thing, just makes me like, it doesn't give a nice feeling in it. It's just like, I don't like people that are trying to proclaim to be something, do something else. On the other hand, there's another part of me that says everybody makes mistakes, even though you're saying, you know, it's a long time and you could have stopped it and whatnot. Fair enough, people make mistakes sometimes, and you can't hold everyone to, you know, you can't mirror them to God or something, that they're infallible. They can't make a mistake. Everybody makes mistakes. But because I didn't really feel him in the first place, this is just another thing for me to add on top of that. Like, well,
all this everybody makes mistakes business. Everybody makes mistakes, fine, but all consequences come from those mistakes. You must get judged for those mistakes the same way you get judged for everything else. So as far as I'm concerned, he's getting judged for this, and he should be getting judged for it.
And that was verse 2 from the Bible of Wahala.
And peace be unto all of you.
So who's this Seti guy? I don't know this.
The Seti guy, I don't know nothing about either, if I'm going to be honest. But he's apparently a crackhead. Or cokehead. That's a lot of people have been saying that he's a cokehead. But I don't know him. I don't know him off the road, you get me? So.
Oh, yeah. And because of this Seti guy now, apparently, on top of the N-word being used, I also read that there was a lot of shadism in the 45-minute video as well.
Oh, yes. He was calling them out. Bino, he was telling him that I'm the real Met, because he's light skinned. He's light skinned, the Seti guy. Not even that light, he's a bit darker than Simple, even.
He's not even that light.
And he was calling him the unmelanated one. You're just upset because I'm melanated, and you look a bit like the white man. That's why you mean blah blah blah. He took it out on him.
So what he's basically saying deep down inside is that because I'm dark, I'm better than you.
See what I'm saying? Can you see the underlying issues?
It was some nonsense.
Mm-hmm. But again, all of this is all a part of flipping post-traumatic slave syndrome. So
you can say that, we can round it up like that. Yeah. But the truth of the matter is, we can call it post-traumatic slave syndrome. The problem is, the person who you're giving that diagnosis to knows about post-traumatic slave syndrome. He talks about it with other people. You know what I'm saying to you?
Yeah,
him to then come and do the same thing again, don't get me wrong, you can be subject to the same thing you've identified in others. Not, I'm not saying that. But
no, not at all.
I am of the opinion that he should have a greater degree of wherewithal about him. You understand what I'm saying? Mm,
okay.
And I don't
but the thing is, he doesn't, obviously, because if this is Webb's talking, for someone who's meant to be on such a high plateau and an advocate for pro-blackness and upliftingness, for him to lose his rag like that and go shoot guns at someone who is also...
He didn't shoot guns.
He did say,
and this is what I said, come on, bruv. But he did try. He said, we can keep this conscious, but if you want, we can take it outside to the back. So he's looking to fight, man.
He's looking, yeah.
But he also said we can keep it conscious, but there was nothing conscious
about it. There was nothing conscious about what he said.
No, because he wanted to take it to a debate. Basically, he offered him out in a debate.
It's not keep it conscious, then. It's we can be conscious. Because at that present time, you're not being conscious.
But that's
you're being ignorant.
No, he was conscious enough to be ignorant.
He thought that was conscious, innit? For them, I don't know what he's conscious. I'm not really a fan of the words conscious and woke anyway. Those both of them annoy me, both words.
Present, how's present?
Present day.
He's present. Yes.
He's present.
But, what's wrong with conscious?
I just don't know. I just think, conscious of what? Are you unconscious? Are you not sleeping?
Well, that is the premise. That is the premise. The idea that you've seen The Matrix,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So the idea that you're present but you're not conscious. You're unconscious. You're living out the script that has been set before you without looking beyond the script.
Nah.
So that's what they mean by unconscious.
To me, Morpheus tried to show you in The Matrix.
Who? Morpheus?
Morpheus.
Who's Morpheus?
Morpheus even tried to show you in The Matrix.
Nah, I'm not involved. I don't agree
with this. But was you clocking the beanie or watching for the agents? Kalashnikov.
There you go.
Yeah. Basically, you're living in limbo.
I don't know. I don't like the word woke, definitely. And I'm not really.
I don't understand woke. I don't know what that is.
There's a difference between woke and conscious, apparently, as well. There's a difference between all of these different... Like, there's proper factions in this black consciousness stuff.
Okay, I understand
anybody,
what woke is.
Anybody can be woke.
Yeah, anybody can be woke. You don't have to have a great verse in history to be woke.
Yeah, so basically you just...
To be conscious, you have to have a verse in history.
I don't know if they say like that, but people that say they're woke means that you're... Good to me. They're basically that you know what's going on, you know what's around you, you can see that there's white supremacy around you, that means you're woke. Yeah. So white people can also be woke, basically, in their capacity.
You don't have, that's what I'm saying, you don't have to have a verse in history to be woke, necessarily. Like, yeah, but for example, when I sit down and watch TV, I don't watch TV often, and I mean that sincerely. Like, maybe once in a whole week, I might sit down in front of a TV to watch, and that's only because I'm with somebody who's watching television, not because I'm watching the TV.
But while I'm sitting there,
when you say watch, sorry, it's going off. When you say watch TV, do you mean actual TV or your television?
No, I mean actual TV. And okay. When I say
nobody watches TV anymore.
When I say watch TV, I'm talking about when you submit yourself to a program
that you haven't selected yourself.
That you haven't selected yourself. And when I say a program, I don't necessarily mean one subject. I mean a program, as in you sit there and you see adverts and all the rest of it between. So I don't watch TV in that sense, or but once a week. And if I sit there watching a television and we'll be watching an advert and I'll be like, did you know it's that da-da-da-da-da-da-da? That to me is what people would be considering as woke. Like, what the advert is trying to sell, I don't normally get, but I do notice all of these other little indices or whatever they call it.
Insurgents.
I know.
Inserts.
Yeah, I notice all these little other things.
Insurrection.
What? Yeah, idiosyncrasies or whatever they call it. I notice all these other little things, and I'm like, did you notice that? And then the person who I'm watching TV with will be like, yeah, actually, I did. That's a bit weird.
Do you mean subliminal messages?
Some of those too.
Put them in the bag, mate. Put them in the bag.
Yeah, some of those. Yeah, so I can understand that somebody can be woke and not necessarily. I don't consider myself conscious.
I think it's both nonsense.
Are you woke?
So wait.
Are you woke? I would say that I'm a weak.
Oh, wow.
So what is a website? So the premise of being woke is being aware of what's going on, seeing the lies, but then being conscious is understanding the lies and knowing not to buy into it.
Being aware of the lies that are there, not necessarily understanding the context of the lies, but being able to see that there is a cloak over the mirror, basically. Mm. Whereas consciousness is seeing the lies, understanding the lies, understanding the context of the lies, understanding the history of the lies, and some of the pathology that goes towards
it. But they call it a community, what I just said. They call it a conscious community. So that means there's a group of people within this community that are conscious.
Yeah.
And other people outside of this community are not. So I don't agree with the term. I don't like it. I hate the term woke. I just cannot stand that term. It's one of these new age social media terms.
You sound like an old man, you know that.
Who?
You.
What? I hate woke. It sounds like one of these young people things.
No, obviously it's annoying, man. I'm woke.
They listen to mumble rap and big tablets.
Simple Simon.
I like this new music.
Simple Simon will never do a declaration that says, I'm woke. I never would. But
stay woke.
I'm not going to do that declaration. But what I would
keep
say...
Keep calm and stay woke.
I'm not involved in it.
If you had to put me in a category and you said to me, yeah, but you seem like one of the woke ones, then I probably wouldn't get offended by it. Although it's not terminology I would use myself.
So does anybody here regard themselves as a child of Zion?
What's that?
A conscious individual.
I don't know what I am anymore, man. You lot have put so many different categories of what I am.
You are an original Ebaita.
I know I'm fat. That's what I know so far. Naija, I'm fat. Boy, I'm fat. I'm so black. Nigerian. That's what I am in the moment. That's what I can 100% say. Because everything else these days seems to have a different category. There's got all these different things. I wouldn't say that I'm necessarily part of the woke community, and I wouldn't say I'm necessarily part of the conscious community. I would just say that I have a sensible head on my shoulders.
Stavros.
Seeing as we're talking about head and shoulders.
Wait, Stavros.
That was such a good segue. Go on.
Do you consider yourself an original child of Zion?
I don't know what that means, so I can't.
Are you conscious?
Not enough. Not as much as I would like to be.
Simple Simon.
Yeah, you asked me this already.
And your answer was?
I wouldn't consider myself conscious.
See, clearly more conscious than you, because you don't know what you asked me 2 seconds ago.
I was a woke. Mr. Wolf.
I'd like to gain more knowledge. So I'd say I am awake. For sure, and semi-conscious.
See, because, well, there you go. Because I think most of us would say we're, in the terms of how Simple Simon just kind of explained it, I think we'd all say we're woke, and maybe we're on the path to being conscious.
As are you, just Mr. Wahala.
Just a foolishness.
So, now to go back to my segue, because it was so good, I'm going to go back to it, head and shoulders. Mr. Wolf, you have something to talk about, and then I have questions to ask you specifically.
There's this new craze going on out there, and it's relating to male extensions or male weave, whatever it is.
Simple Simon, I'm looking at the shiny boldness of Mr. Wolf's head as he's talking about it. I just thought you'd need to know that.
Just let it shine.
So can you also see the shadow?
Yes.
What shadow, man?
The shadow three, where the hair used to be, bro.
6 o'clock and 9 o'clock shadow.
So well, basically, Mr. Wolf has got a shiny bald head.
Mr. Wolf's hair looks like it went back to the future.
Yeah. Wow. Oh,
so
he has
a DeLorean headline.
Marty!
We're Marty!
Back! And I watched Back to the Future the other day as well.
Christmas special, of course.
Part two.
Let the man finish. Let the man finish.
But anyway, no, there's these YouTube clips going on out there, and it's to do with guys with bald head. And they are putting on extensions, they're putting on weave, and it looks like that they have a fantastic hairline. They're getting brilliant haircuts done by the barbers.
He just said a fantastic hairline, yes.
Yeah, I just want to know what the man them think about that.
Can I ask you a question?
I would love to know what women think
Simple
about
Simon
it.
Simon would like to ask you a question. Did you watch all the videos?
Yeah. Well, listen, I would like to say, like I always said, it don't matter if it's man, it don't matter if it's woman. We bun weave on the ASN podcast.
Bun weave.
Bun eye weave. Bun it, face weave.
I should be doing
bun
it.
Hair weave. Because there's beard weave. There's people are getting beard weave, you know?
I think I use that term. I created that term, face weave. Face weave for me is...
Eye weavers.
Them eye weave business that come out of the woman's head. But in reality, when you look at it, if you don't know that the guy has done that thing, and Mr. Wolf is saying that he would never, ever do that. Do you understand? I will tell you what I will do.
Go on, hit me.
But I won't do that.
But I won't do that.
I would do anything for him, but I won't do that.
Oh, no. Oh, God, I set myself up for that one.
You did.
You did.
Yeah. So, I just wanted to know what the man didn't think about that.
Well, no, tell us what you would do.
We'll go into that in a minute.
I'll put out a question to everybody. If you did become follicly challenged.
You haven't even answered his question before you're asking another one.
He hasn't. He didn't want to answer his question.
He just asked you a question which blatantly said, how do you feel about the weave?
About the weave? What's wrong with you,
which
man?
Was another question I was going to ask on top of that question.
Oh, yeah.
But we all know how we feel about weave anyway. ESN do not deal with weave.
That's us, but the people out there don't know how we feel about weave.
Ladies and gentlemen of the podcast, let us know how you feel about weave.
Oh, my days.
We are the gentlemen of the podcast.
The listeners.
No, my days.
This as well as
this,
us.
This is when you know that we're rusty.
I'm not woke, innit?
We're even forgetting there's other people in the world that might be listening to this.
Stavros is saying that I don't agree with weave. I went out of my way to even find a woman that didn't wear weave ever because that is something that I just can't co-sign, put my name beside, stand across from, or co-sign. It's just wrong. I feel it in my soul for some reason. I've got reasons, and then as people have challenged my reasons over time, the reasons, some of them even disintegrate, and I still don't care. I just can't deal with it. Mm-hmm. So with a man, no offense, women, but it's even worse when a man is doing it, because as a woman, society has deemed it acceptable, and even in the workplace, especially if you're brought up in a European or American society, then they even want black women to wear weave. It's like it's encouraged because they don't even want you to have your own natural hair.
So I
can even almost understand it a bit more that, you know, I want to work in this kind of environment. They say this is the type of hair I need to do, mm-hmm. and I'm willing to accept to do that to get to this place. I can even deal with that, yeah. But for a man, what? Come on now. You should know better than that. You should do better than that. Be better than that. Come on, man. Come on. So Stavros is saying no, and no again.
Simple Simon, I'm going to come in there real quick. That wasn't right. Yeah, man. I'm saying no.
Why are you saying no, though?
Because to me, the whole thing's bizarre. Like...
How bizarre?
It's bizarre in a sense... Joker. It's bizarre in a sense that we've gone from... See what I did there? We've gone from extensions... idiot. we've gone from extensions to...
All of us, weave.
Weave. And then we've gone from... gone from synthetic weave to coveting real hair weave, which is just even more bizarre to me.
Then yucky.
Yeah, and then, like, we spend extra money on real hair that looks real when we put it on our own head. But we've already got our own hair. Doesn't make any sense to me. It just doesn't make any sense. But
basically, you're saying we've done a lot.
We've done everything we can.
I think the only thing, the difference between the men and the women's one, which I'm still not giving them any type of of parts is the fact that obviously these men have no hair. So they're just putting hair on top of their head. Women usually actually have hair and they're putting hair
on top of their head. Because the men will have hair usually. It's just they have no hair in a certain part, but their head grows hair.
Well, okay, so they have no hair on the top of their heads.
Yeah, but the thing that was amazing for me was I just watched one of the videos that Mr. Wolf was showing there, and basically, man sprays adhesive onto the head and then applies the hair to the adhesive.
That's a good toupee, boy.
Leave
me out, toupee, bro. Because I mean, what women
can you wash
or,
it
or, or our black women?
I'm assuming so.
Do, leave me out, because most of our black women, well, the ones that use weave, we know that there are people of a different background. You know, Caucasian people do use weave, but we're talking about the blacks here. They have regular afro hair, and then they are now putting most of the weave that they put in their hair is straight, yeah. So it's straight hair. So when I've seen these videos of these men that are putting weave in their hair or this thing that they're putting in, it's of a natural look. They're not putting straight this thing in their hair. So I'm not trying to co-sign it.
Of course you are. No, I'm not.
I will not do it.
You sound like you're campaigning.
I'm not campaigning.
I personally think he's campaigning for
it.
You sound like you're campaigning to make it all right in the future.
No, I'm just saying that there's a big difference. There's a big difference, that's all.
This is Mr. Wolf here. If you ever become follicly challenged, I will recommend weave. Male pattern baldness weave.
Fucker.
So, Mr. Wolf, are you actually saying that?
I already know what's coming, but anyway, just ask the people, man. Right. Ask them.
No. Would you consider doing something to rewind time in terms of
reinvigorate your follicles?
Yeah, that is a nice
rejuvenate your scalp.
Yeah. Yes, I would. And
the weave.
Not the weave.
Okay.
The weave is something that isn't a part of you that you're putting on the top of your head. So you know, just like a hairpiece.
So, Mr. Wolf, would you do a Rooney?
A Trump?
I would.
You'd do a Rooney?
I would do a Rooney, if that's what you want to call it. Basically, there are loads of different companies offering
regrowth. You researched it?
You can't miss it. They're all on TV. They're all on TV now. Doing loads of adverts. So you got these companies on, they're all on a train and newspapers, television adverts, and they're offering men who are follicly challenged, men who are bald, the chance to regrow their hair. And I would consider it, yes.
What's the cricket?
And I would feel no way about it. I don't care.
Is it Shane Warne that's the cricketer that's an ambassador?
Yeah, Shane Warne, and there's a few others.
Have you seen a black person do this yet?
I've seen photographs.
Of blacks,
yeah.
I'll be honest with you, yeah. The person who figures out how to do hair growth and elongation of life is going to make money.
But you can grow your hair back. You can.
But, okay. So where do they get this hair from? Because I thought they got it from your batty.
That's disgusting. What the hell is wrong with you?
I don't know. They get some. There is some form of...
They get the hair from...
No, skin grass. That's what they get from your batty.
Okay, well...
I can get skin grass from anywhere.
Yeah, but they usually take it from your back for some reason.
There's two methods.
Bottom or the upper thigh.
There's two methods. And yes, I have done a little bit of research. There's two methods that you can use. Well, the two methods that I would consider would be the one where you do laser treatment and they also give you 2-2 cream and tablet.
2-2 cream and tablet.
Yeah. You know? So the laser treatment is to open up your... It's to open up your kind of follicles, and then to the cream and the tablets is to give the hair the strength that was in there, because it's in there, it's just that everything's closed up and stopped growing. And the other one is to take hair from the back of your head, hair follicles, and plant it in the area where you are challenged.
Plant.
Basically, just to take it out and put it into another place. And those are the two methods that I'll consider.
Real talk, do you think...
And it is my hair. It's not another person's hair. It's not horse hair or whatever.
Do you think Jesus would agree with this procedure?
Why not?
We were talking about this off air, so just going off by this. Obviously, mm-hmm. you're a bald-headed human being.
I am, Cole Jack.
And I asked you, you know, do you shave butter your scalp?
He's balding, not bald.
He's bald. Do you shave butter your scalp? And you said no. You said you...
I've got a variety of different things. There's one cocoa butter spray and coconut oil type thing, and I also put Dax on the top of my head. Yeah,
yeah, but I don't get the Dax.
It's there, isn't it? It's just there.
Are you just trying to reminisce? You know what?
The Dax is actually the Dax is actually for my son. It's there, and sometimes when my hair,
so you steal your son's Dax. That's what you're saying.
And sometimes when my hair or my head is dry, I just grab a little tiny piece and just plant it.
You know when you do it,
but Dax is not really moisturizing for scalp, is it?
It helps. It does help me.
Question: so when you do this, when you use this Dax, and
you're fascinated by the Dax
on your scalp, do you look in the mirror and remember the time?
Do you remember?
That's perfect, man. You gotta play that Michael Jackson song. You get me when you're editing a piece, stuff.
Do you remember the time? You know where you got the memories? Or going back and back them days there where you used to have the low cut fade and you used to take advantage of the fact that you could get fades and, you know, cut your hair off before just because you could.
Okay. Just to let you, man, know, I'm cool with my bald head, innit?
A simple sign.
You can't be cool if you want to get it done.
No, I'm cool. This is how it is. I'm not. In a state of depression because I've got bald head. I'll shave my head and I'll just get on with it.
Can I ask you a question?
But there is an option. If the option was there, I would take it.
Do you dream of dreadlocks?
Definitely not. Me, I don't want dread.
Webb said, do you remember when you had hair?
Of course.
I can't imagine you with like a full head of hair.
Yeah, it's about 10 years ago when I started losing, you know.
Did you see how he said he didn't want dreadlocks? Like he was the worst thing in the
place. He did say it like, don't insult me.
He said it like it's an insult.
My preference is not dread.
Got more hair than you, though.
I know you have. Go and sit down.
You took the hair. You know what we could do? We could cut some of Simple's hair off and like make like cane roll on your head. Stick it down.
You know, cane roll on a grown man is just don't seem right.
Ooh.
I don't know.
You know what? You know what? You know who I've heard really say this more than anyone else?
It just don't seem
right. You know who I've heard more say this more than anyone else?
What, the woke people?
Women.
The woke people.
Women say they do not like grown men with cane roll.
Unless they're D'Angelo.
Yeah. D'Angelo's the only one I've ever heard. But no, any other...
Not D'Angelo. What's the other guy's name? Trey Songz.
He's but he cut it off.
I didn't even know Trey Songz even had braids.
You did.
Braids?
Drake has got a lyric when he was cussing somebody and he said basically...
nobody but Trey Songz.
Yeah, nobody... No grown man should have braids apart from Trey Songz because he's my bedroom, basically.
Yeah. Like, it's a known thing that women... Like, I've seen a lot of women say they don't agree with men that wear braids. And then even just taking it to the next level, if you've got braids and beads as well, it's just gone.
Braids and beads. You know what?
Stevie's the only runner.
Because I ask women, you know, when they're braiding their son's hair, and it's like, would you deal with a man that had no? So why are you braiding your son's hair? It's like, well, because he's young. It's all right to do it when they're young, but they must grow out of it.
Age appropriate hairstyle.
So what's the cutoff age for braids?
That is the question.
I think it's more when you get up to your 20s. I reckon. I think you can still do it in a 16-year-old, maybe 17, 18, as long as it's still.
You know what I think? I think if a woman met a man who's self-employed, making a decent money. And they feel he takes care of himself in any other way, or the other ways he looks good, you know, he dresses well, his body's whatever. I think they give it a blind and say, well, it's cool.
So he ticks 8 out of 9 boxes, and they'll go for it.
I'm not saying that they won't go for the man. I'm saying they don't like it, though.
Okay, you know what? You're right. Let me just take all that stuff back, because it's not really applicable, I guess. Yeah, you're right. If there's enough things about a man you like, then you'll let certain things slide.
Do you guys
understand why a woman wouldn't like a grown man with braids? Like, for yourself, do you understand the psychology behind that?
I think
do you have a problem with it yourself?
I think personally they probably associate it with children. They associate it with a child.
Because Allen Iverson had braids forever.
Yeah, that's... I can't really speak for the Americans.
Are we talking about practice?
I'm talking more about...
Are we talking about practice?
What are you talking about?
The Americans will know.
but
my nephew Dion will know that one day.
But I'm saying, in the end, it's more of a case of... I think they're associated with... Because they do their child's hair in that manner, they're just associated with children. I just think that's it. There's a child's hairstyle. It's not a man's hairstyle. An old big man's got to go and get his hair braided. That's what I think they think.
All right, put it this way, because we're all of a certain age, but you think of somebody in their 50s, 60s with braids. You see that a 50-year-old shouldn't be having braids. So well, I guess a woman just cuts, rather than, because I think people at our age still see ourselves as young.
You see yourself as young.
I think we still see ourselves as younger than we actually are. Even as much as I say I'm old, and I feel old when I'm hanging around younger people, I feel old. But that's in relative to them, I feel old. But in just by myself, solo, I don't feel old. If you get what I mean? Okay, when you were 16 and you're looking at somebody double your age, you saw them as an old person.
30 is old to me. Still now.
All right. Okay. What do you guys think then? Do you think that when you were looking at your people your own age, 20 years ago? Because you were of age where you could recognise that. Do you think you saw that person as being old?
Simple, Simon. I've been saying it for years. Once you go past 25, you're mutton, as far as I'm concerned.
Mutton?
Mutton. Mm-hmm. That's it. Your glory days are behind you. And I've been saying that for a long time.
Not for me. I mean, when I was young and I looked at, you know, adults or older people, you know, double my age, 16 to 36 or whatever, I saw them as old. But right now, I'm with you. I'm of age.
That's what happens.
I don't feel old. We don't dress the way people act.
I'm a mature individual, but I'm not an old man.
Okay, this is the question. This is what I say when people got that level of oldness, yeah?
A denial.
Sorry.
Would you wear jeans and shoes?
Jeans and shoes?
Then you're old.
No, bro.
Then you're old.
I see many of. Now, see, what I'm saying is different styles out here, you know. Wahala.
No.
You know what he's thinking of?
No.
He's thinking of them old men with their flares and their funny shoes.
I didn't say flares.
I've got, listen, there's certain styles that you can wear, boat shoes, Bridget, and you're not looking old. You get me?
But the fact that you said boat shoes. And maybe certain other shoes.
Jeans and shoes. I know that. If that is your personal preference, if you can go to a location, if it's not a club where you can't wear trainers, and you decide, if you go out and you know, today I'm going to put on a pair of denim.
When I was 16, I was wearing jeans and shoes.
Then you was old that time as well.
Bruv.
You was old that time. That's why your hair started to lose so early.
Because you're chatting about.
Trust me, jeans and shoes, I don't care, the old man. Fashion.
I think
that's when you take it to the next level. When you say, I'm not wearing the trainer today.
100% disagree with
Simple
that.
Simple Simon might have figured it out. I think I might have figured it out.
Go ahead.
Women don't like adult men with braids because who braids men's hair?
Women.
Other women. Boom.
So it's probably those women that don't want to have to braid that man's hair.
No, they don't want their man to go to another woman to have their head in between their legs to get their head braided.
If you had braids, would you let another man braid your hair?
Hell no!
So it's a sexual thing to have a man touching your hair. But you let a man cut your hair.
You let a man cut your hair. Though.
Yeah, but it's different, you know. There's a, you know, you're caressing the head top.
Yeah, but he does
it. No, there's men that will angle your head. There's men that will cut your hair. They will put, if they cut your hair bald in the barbers, then they'll put all cream and rub it and all that stuff for you.
No, he just shaves it.
He doesn't put the cream. Well, there's other places when they do your face, even they put cream to cream your face, cut it off. Put alcohol, like a proper shave. They do a lot of sort of things that's more look like a grooming thing, almost like a massage.
Well, the difference is that when it comes to cane roll and doing those kind of hairstyles, you seldomly have a man doing that. It's not something that is commonplace. So what is common to us is to have a man is to go to a barbershop in a male environment and get our hair cut. When it comes to braiding your hair from birth or whenever you start braiding. A woman, it's known that a woman is the one to do that. So now, if you decide now to go to a shop where they braid hair and you see that there's a man that's about to do it, it doesn't matter who it is, you're going to feel a way about it.
Would you be comfortable having a female barber your hair?
I would, yeah.
But you're uncomfortable having a man braid your hair?
Yes.
He just loves women so much that he's happy to let a woman...
But what I will say about cultures is that the Caribbean, Jamaican or whatever, that at my barbershop, there's another shop next door who does women's hair, and you see a lot of guys in there braiding their head. None of them African guys, by the way. Most of them, if not all of them.
Some of them from Cameroon?
Nah.
Okay.
You can usually spot a Cameroon by the colour of the garment they wear.
It's the same as Jamaican colour garment, though.
Very true. But I would say that a lot of Caribbean guys braid their hair.
I think they do it, but I don't think it's a big thing in the Caribbean.
So what you're saying, Mr. Wolf, is that African men are homophobic?
Wow. Where did that go to? Man just wrote the words down and planted it down my throat. Wow. One time.
That's it. Okay, so going back to what we were talking about with braiding the hairs now. Yeah, you got a daughter.
Braiding the hairs.
Braiding the hairs. Mm-hmm. With braids and beads. Braids. Right. Would you braid your daughter's hair?
Yeah, I would.
So what's the problem then? So you braid your daughter's hair because she's a... Would you braid your son's hair? If your mum wasn't around and he could braid hair, and
my son had his hair braided up until he was about 4.
Yeah, but would you braid his hair?
If I could have, I would have.
So then. Yeah. What's the difference now? If you do that, you're teaching him that a man can braid the next man's hair.
But you're saying that a man can't braid the next man's hair. Nah, because when you go into that environment of a barber shop, when it's time to cut your hair, you would get a man to cut your hair. And it's common and very unlikely that you will have a man braiding another man's hair. Even a father braiding a son's hair. It's just not something that you'll find anywhere.
Ladies and gentlemen, he said...
Father. If you had sons, guys, would you braid your son's hair? Would you braid your daughter's hair first and foremost? Because two of you have got daughter's hair. So would you braid your daughter's hair?
It can be done.
Yes.
It could be done.
Yeah.
Does that mean yes?
I've done my daughter's hair, but I haven't braided
it. How did you do it? You just put it in a bun.
Bun and
such a useless
I can plait hair, you know. I can plait in it. I've plaited her hair a little bit.
I mean, you tried to do her hair like it's pounded yam and you tried to roll it into one ball.
When I've done her hair, which has only been a couple of times, you know, it hasn't been something common because her mum does it or she takes it somewhere, is that she has never had an issue. She's never cried or she never cried. She never kind of felt that there was, you know, because when you do comb that hair out, it can be a little uncomfortable.
Yeah, but you're saying all this, but did she look like a Wu-Tang reunion afterwards?
Nah, she looked fine.
Are you sure? When she went to school, did it?
And she wasn't in pain.
Did you ask, who did your hair today? Daddy did it.
She didn't
Daddy
go school.
Did my hair.
She didn't go to school. It was on a weekend.
The teachers are all asking, what's going on in the home?
A weekend when she was
what's going on in the home? Why do you look like this? Daddy did my hair.
I think it's for me.
Is everything all right?
Miss, Daddy did my hair. He's coming crying for no reason. What happened? Daddy did my hair.
I think it's a big thing if a man can do his daughter's hair. You know what I mean? I personally, yes.
I can do
one.
That.
One of our brothers, I think, done his daughter's hair, and he put a picture up on social media. Lovely photograph, classic, beautiful.
I can do my daughter's hair. I don't, but I think that portal's fake, by the way.
Yeah, but fake or not, he still looked good. You get me?
Is this someone we know?
Of course, it's someone we know.
Of course, it was.
It's one of our regulars.
Oh yes, yes.
But yeah,
it's one of our
regulars.
It's one of our brothers, man.
I can do some hair, but my missus is a loctician, so she's taught me bits and bobs.
Is that the term?
Yes,
loctician.
Loctician family.
Yes,
I'll lock your head off.
So I've learned little bits and bobs to do hair, but before that I learned how to plait anyway. I don't know why I learned how to plait. I think I did it because, you know, in school you used to have them stupid things, that them wrap around things that you wrap around and you can make like the bangles or whatever it is.
Did you do the trolls?
What, the
troll dolls?
I think I put some weave on that.
With the troll dolls with the long hair.
I think I might have done that before. Yeah. I don't know, but I learned how to plait hair anyway. I learned how to plait something.
Yeah. Stavros can plait hair. So
I can plait, but I can't cane.
Yeah, I can plait, I can't cane.
Yeah, I don't understand how they make it stick down.
It's because you instead of going down to the end of the thing,
you're always pulling from the root.
Always from the root.
So you don't look like you know what you're doing.
Yeah, but to actually literally do it is
an extra. I know the theory of it, but doing it is it will take.
Okay, maybe that's what I can do. I can plait then. I can plait.
So Stavros is going to learn at some point. Hopefully, the plan is that I'll learn. So that my wife doesn't always have to. Do
I'll actually need to see what would happen when you produce a hairstyle for your daughter.
Daddy cuts his own hair. I can do my daughter's.
Yeah, you can cut your own hair. That's complete. Have you seen your hairline?
my hairline is dodgy anyways.
You've got about 4 different lines where you can see it's going back.
Even when I go to the barber, they don't cut it straight either. So there's clearly.
I'm not saying it's cutting it straight. I'm saying you can see.
Shut your mouth.
You can see the shape where your hair used to be. And when you decided to take it back.
No, it just there.
And let's be real, yeah, because we have to be honest out here. It's only since the 2000, maybe or 7, 8, 9, that Nigerian barbers anyway, or African barbers have learnt to not push their hair back right to the back. So you're taking it back to them styles. Well, you're taking it far, far back.
I think I look decent.
I'm not saying you look bad, but for somebody that cuts their own hair, it's really good. But your hairline goes back, and your hairline's gone back more because you keep pushing it back.
No, because I cut it off. I'm bringing it back. Yeah, I'll cut it
lean
off.
Back. Lean back.
You got a Ghanaian hairline? No, the last time I cut my hair was when I got married. As in, when I got my hair cut, and that was the first time since my 20s.
So you went to a barber.
So between 20 and the time I got married, I'd never went to a barber.
Did the barber say, "Chale, long time"?
Didn't really have a particular. Unlike the people that frequent barbers and have a particular barber they go to, I never had, because I can count on my hands the amount of times I went to the barber.
He
in my
didn't
life,
say
full
no.
Stop.
Mm-hmm. No, and yeah, we were children that was taken to the barbers when we were young. My mum used to cut our hair.
Yes.
Used to cut everyone's hair in the house. Me, Stav, and my dad all got trimmed by mum. Mum will sit us down in one seat, put the yellow thing around our neck, and that's it. You weren't having no. There was no such thing as a fade in my house. There was one level.
Yeah. Okay, we weren't allowed to have fades in our house. Okay. We will get in trouble if we had.
That's when we was young though.
Even well.
It was young. When we got older, you could do what you wanted. We just didn't go.
Older what age?
Probably about 13, 14, we could probably do what we wanted.
Yeah, well, that's
but
a
not,
decent.
But not any form of.
Nah.
It had to be clean.
The first time that I actually went to get my hair cut was in South London, Wandsworth. And it was actually just a black man in a hairdressing salon. So it was a white hairdressing salon. It was a black guy, and me and my virgin went in there. And we got a wicked flat top fade. I went home and my dad just looked at me with some serious side eye, you know. I think my mum had a word of him, just louder boy. Because he always used to just get the scissors out. And
leave him alone.
He's no shears, you know.
He's growing up around his ruffian.
Scissors, bruv. You get me? So, you know what I mean? So when
you didn't even say clippers, you know, he said shears. He said shears.
You get me? Scissors. So, and I remember they were yellow. Yellow scissors and... My dad just butchered the head top, boy.
See, my son will get a good haircut from his dad. Again, going...
No, you can't cut other people's hair, though. You tried to cut my hair. There was a time that Stav cut my hair and I went to school and I got cut for so long.
Yeah, but... Okay, you went
to school. He made my hair look like Dragon Ball Z.
Okay, you were in school.
And so what?
Yeah, so how old was I?
You decided to practice on my head. That's the head to practice on.
That's how many years ago?
Where I got cut.
20 years?
Huh?
Nearly 20 years? 17, 18 years?
Yeah,
what? So I've got 18 years of experience on that. You can't judge me by 18.
No, you cut my hair after that and it still took 8.
Have you still been cutting your hair?
For staff to cut your hair, it takes 4 hours.
One at a time. Who's speaking?
Sorry, this is Mr. Wolf. Have you still been cutting hair? Other than your own?
No, I usually just cut
So you haven't got that years of experience.
But I will have it with my child.
Or with my son. 4 hours.
Sorry, Webster, how can you have the experience of cutting your son's hair when you're only cutting your own hair?
I said I will have.
But you're not going to cut anybody else's hair?
As in, when I do it, he'll be my practice.
It's child abuse, don't
you? Yeah,
there you go. Poor boy, man.
That is actual child abuse.
Poor boy, because he'll be young enough, he won't understand it.
Oh, my God.
So when he goes nursery, comes back with a black eye or whatever.
Daddy cut my hair.
Daddy
cut my hair.
And then the girl will be, "Daddy ran my hair."
Both children is dead.
Mommy ran out of love.
Stavros is boy.
Everyone's looking at the mother. Like, it's not even him that they'll blame. The mum they'll start to blame.
Daddy cut my hair.
What kind of mother is this?
He said he's not spending the money to take me to barb my hair.
Nigerians call it barb,
but one of the reasons why I decided to take my son to the barbers rather than do it myself, I could have, but I just thought it was, I mean, my barbershop is very boisterous, loud, and you know, there's a lot, just like most barbershops, there's a lot of things going on in there. I just thought it would be good for him to enter an environment like that. He was around a lot of women pampering him and doing all these kind of things, and he was getting his hair braided. And I got him into the barbershop seat after he said, "Dad, I want to cut my hair." And I got him into football.
So he became, it helped him, help mold him.
So you're saying that it's kind of like a rite of passage.
Yes, yes.
I can't disagree with that.
Just going, well, we didn't have this rite of passage, but going on this, do you think that barbershops have a misogynistic view in the barbershops? Do you think it's a cesspool of misogyny in a barbershop?
Damn.
Yes.
So do you think that is the right place to take your son to learn about manly things? If you think that is a cesspool of misogyny?
Now, my barbershop is quite level and even in terms of the opinions people.
My barbershop is quite boisterous.
It's boisterous, but there's different characters in there, isn't it? You know what I mean? Everybody is chauvinistic.
Mr. Wolf.
You know what I'm saying?
Every barber's has an array of characters that are in there.
The way I'm looking at
and when dad, there's children in there.
When did you go to the barbers?
When?
So says the dread.
Judge. I don't go there for myself. I have been.
Okay.
I know people that run barbershops, etc., etc. But what I'm saying is, like,
etc.,
there are a multitude of characters in there, but underlying, there is misogyny.
There's misogyny everywhere you go.
Yes, but the barbers is a concentrated misogyny.
That's what I said, the cesspool of misogyny.
It's a concentration of it.
Like, in my barbers the other day, the guy was talking about how he has four or five women, and that's just the way he runs things.
that's not misogynistic, though.
What? Nah, bro, the way he's looking, I have one here, I have one in Ghana, and he has one in London, and a couple scattered around, and they were talking about basically the same. You know, I'm just doing what I'm doing with all these women, and I think to myself, is that something I want my son to be hearing outside on the streets?
Can someone give me a definition of the word, please?
What, misogyny?
Yes.
We'll continue. I'll have a look. Continue.
All right. So yeah, he will give you the proper, because we like to have dictionary definitions on ESN, because even though we're eloquently saying nothing, we want to be saying something sometimes, isn't it? But yeah, I don't know. I think that it's just. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, and I do think that men should take their sons to the barbers. I'm just saying that for me, I don't know how much I want them to learn from the barbershop.
There's a lot of X-rated talk in there and a lot of subjects that are not child-friendly. But when there are children in there, the subjects do change based on who's in the barbershop. Sometimes there's quite a bit of women in there and the conversations will change a little bit.
Dislike of, contempt for, or ingrained prejudice against women.
So yeah, I don't think there's a bit of misogyny in the barbershop.
There's definitely extreme objectification of women folk in the barbershop.
But that's not what misogyny is.
But then that's a wrong usage of the word, because barbers don't dislike women, they just use and abuse.
They love women.
If you abuse them, then that means you can't like them if you're abusing them, are you?
Abuse in the most subtle sense of the word.
Oh my God. For me, I think... I'm just saying, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm not just saying that no men should take their sons to the barbers. And I think you do learn a lot of things in the barbershop, but I think we need to be careful about what we're, pushing out to the kids to say that this is the behaviour of men.
But
you've
got to remember the kids go to the barbershop. Every day.
Yeah,
the barbershop teaches
pack mentality and alpha maleism. Because if you go and sit down in the barbershop, there's always one that's established as the almost as a pack leader, so to speak, and then there are the others that are scrambling for the limelight in a sense. Yeah. There's a hierarchy system in the barbers.
I don't think so.
Any environment you go to, there will be that.
Yeah, but I don't think it's as much as what Simple's saying in a barbershop, because it's quite level. There's one, unless you're talking about people that actually cut your hair or whatever, that's a completely different thing. But when I'm talking about the discussions, it seems in a barbershop you can come in and speak to somebody you do not know, like never met before in your life. And you can have a conversation for an hour, talking about whatever conversations that's come up in the time. So I remember one time I was sitting in a barbershop. In fact, one time Stav came with me to the barbershop.
And was the hierarchy was set that Stav was the boss of this place.
He was talking about
the hierarchy. But it's true. Is it not true? By the time I left, the man was like, yes, please.
Basically, he was the most talkative out of the
people. No, it's not about being most talkative. Because towards the end, there was one dude that was very talkative. But I ran that conversation, as in I was the boss of that conversation.
Because the conversation was about you. No. You also could have run a conversation about someone else.
No,
It was about you going to the dark side. That was all about.
I was telling them, mans, about certain things.
About Ghanas. That's what he was telling them about.
They were Ghanaians, and I was telling them about them. He said, don't tell me nothing, man. And they fell back as well.
But Ghanaians, that's how they are, innit? They're calm.
They fell back, man. Your people.
Kwame's always calm, innit? But I think.
That's what the hairline looks like, it looks. Because they're going back.
But I think. He's one of us. I think it's quite open in the barbershops. I think it's more of a case where everybody has their say, and then after you leave, you just leave. A lot of tension in barbershops as well, times, depending on what's going on.
You can have a hierarchy and everybody has their say.
Yeah, but I just don't see it as a distinct hierarchy most times when I go to the barbers. That's what I'm saying. I don't see.
I think it will depend on what barbershop you go to. Yeah. But for my one, if you are not sharp and if you're not ready verbally, stay in the corner and be quiet, innit? Otherwise, you could get chopped down. And my thing is there's no real hierarchy in my place. Everybody is of a level and everybody's got their different strengths. And we even created a WhatsApp group a few months ago, and I'll tell you, it's ruthless in there. It's ruthless.
You know what Mr. Wolf said earlier about there being some sort of rites of passage. Well, he didn't use the word rites of passage, somebody else did. But I do agree with the idea that it is kind of like a passage for especially black men. I don't know what it is like for women or for people of other cultures, but I think for black men, it's like a rite of passage to come up in the system of getting your hair cut. And this is something that me and my brother missed out on because, like was mentioned, we got our hair cut at home. Now, that is the only reason I would take my son to the barber, for them to experience that, which I did not experience. Not because I think anyone's going to do it particularly super much better. I mean, they'll do it better than me, but I'll do it good enough. So that's the reason I might take them, if I decide to take them when they get to a certain age.
Barbers are almost like barbers and salons are almost like the pillar of the black community, man.
You know, I was having this conversation just the other day, Wahala, is that is the one business that they can't take away. You get me?
They can't.
That is a conversational point in and of itself. Because you can what kind of black man or black woman own that somebody else can't come over and do it for? We can sell your food better than you, yeah? We can sell your hair products better than you, yeah? We can sell a lot of things better. But when it comes to getting your hair cut, black people are very, very uncomfortable going to anyone other than another black person.
Even a particular black person as well.
unless you want your hair looking more European. In which case, you're
with no fade. Yeah. When I was young, we used to call guys up in Birmingham because whenever we went up there, they never had a proper fade. So if it's not a proper fade, you take the E off. And we used to call it a Birmingham fad. You
get me? Wow.
That does sound like a racial slur. A
Birmingham fad.
You got fad, mate.
Birmingham fad. Birmingham disrespectful.
Okay, so we're moving on to the next topic.
We're going to get a few messages from folks in Birmingham now.
Exactly.
We do love you, but it is full of full of roundabouts.
No, man. Birmingham man's are real.
I'm not a real one.
Full of roundabouts, man.
What's the phone called up there? Is it 0121? No, it's not 0121.
I have no idea what that
is. Big up the Birmingham man.
It's 0161. He wants
that man from Brom.
0161, yeah. Big up the
Birmingham man. He wants that man from Brom.
A woman has 3 kids which do not have the same father.
That's it, bye.
Oh yeah, I'm gone.
She only gets support from one of the fathers.
Hey, she make a god.
The father that provides for his kid, or child, because Simple Simon is the word kid.
Thank you very much.
Gave the mother 500, it says dollars here, but let's change it to pounds.
Sterling.
To cash. Get money. His child's Christmas gift. The mother chooses...
A whole 500.
£500.
That's a lot of money.
Well, in sterling, that would be about... It's $500. It's about £379 pre-exit. Anyways, the mother chooses to get all 3 children Christmas gifts with his 500 knicker. The father of the child got upset about that. Is the mother wrong for getting all 3 children gifts with the £500?
Yes. She is wrong, but I don't think that she's... I think she's wrong for doing it without telling them that she's going to do it. My personal opinion. If the man's giving you money for a particular thing, and you said you're going to use that money for that particular thing, and then you use that money for something else...
Let's say she didn't say that. He just gave her the money. This is money for my... For some reason, he can't get it himself. Yeah, he's too lazy or he can't do it. He's overseas. Here's the money. Get my child a gift.
Simple Simon...
I've received your money, she says. Yes, I'll do that, daddy.
Simple Simon, I'm sorry to be a pain in the bother, but I've got a question.
Go ahead.
Is his child the first child?
does that make any difference?
Well, because
I'm just going for some.
If his child is the last child, then he knows that she's already got two children.
That's all.
And
he sees it as a punishment.
What?
You're seeing it as a punishment.
Who me?
Yes.
Seeing what as a punishment?
I'm the line I thought you were going down is, if you decided to have a child with somebody that's got two children with two different men, and you want it to be the third, then anything that comes from that is your business. That's what I thought you were going to say, but I'm sorry if I was wrong.
That's cold-blooded. It's quite funny.
That's similar to what you're going to say.
No, I was going to say, basically, if... Well, I don't know. He might not have known about the other two children if his child was the first child. If his child was the last child, then he knows about the other two children.
How can you not know, as the first child, that you're involved in this person's life, that they don't have two other children, that your son or daughter doesn't have a brother and sister? You must know.
Okay, fair enough. I don't know. This one's a difficult one for me.
I don't think it's difficult. You're asking if she is she wrong for doing that?
Yeah.
She's wrong.
Stavros is saying she's wrong as well.
I don't think there's... I personally wouldn't have a big problem with her doing that, but I know she's wrong for doing it. Because the money was given to this child, to this woman, to buy his child a present.
I would have a big problem.
No, with her doing. She's no, you're right. When I think about it, she's wrong, and I got a big problem with it as well.
Yes,
because
he gave her the money to buy the present for his child.
Look, me being the type of person that I am, if I was to put myself in that situation where I'm happy to be with a woman or have a child with a woman that's got children from other parents before, at some point, especially if I'm still with a woman, if I'm not just some random dude that's I'm number three in the list and there's number four coming down the road. If I'm number three and I'm there for good, then those two children I have to take some sort of participation in, because they're going to be around me at some point, I'm assuming, yeah? They're going to be around me. So I don't mind, I have a problem, especially if I'm born in like that. Here's 100 or 200 or 300 for each of those children for you to get something for, if their dads are not going to get them anything. Well, for my child, I'm sorry, favoritism, is my child. So I'm going to give them 500, and this is the gift for my child. Get them something very nice. And get something for the other children too, so they don't feel left out.
But don't
give what I'm giving to my child and give it to somebody else.
When you lot will answer, I'm going to add a variant to this question that somebody asked before, and I think it's very relevant to it.
Webs, you've been so... You've been quiet, man.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Yeah, I was listening to what you're saying and thinking about that. She is wrong for spending the money, and she should get a slap straight away. And
wow,
I'd take the presents off the other kids as well.
Wait, ESN does not advocate the beating of women over presents.
Wait, hang on. Sorry. Did you say you'd take the presents off the other children? But what did the children do?
Any reverse center?
They were there.
So yeah. let me get this right.
That's not nice.
No, but you.
Webslinger said.
Why are you buying the other kids' presents out of my money? For my little job. Nah.
When I did a Ghostface Killer, I said I'll slap the woman and take the kids to the job. Take the kids. Wow, that's hardcore, man.
Call me bad Santa, but that's wrong. I'm sorry.
All right, that is your jokey answer, I'm assuming. Give us the real answer.
To be honest, I wouldn't be impressed with her doing that, spending my money on my child, on all the other children.
Because they're not like my kids. Some bastards out here, man.
No, they're not. When
we say it, they know it's not our kids, but we just sound like some bastards. Like, I could see an image of child begging.
The children are the bastards.
Wow.
quite literally, yes.
How do you know they were all born out of wedlock? How do you know she's been married three times? Just making assumptions out here.
It's true. Okay, I'll give you that one.
They're my kids, so they're
best. I want to hear what Mr. Wolf says. As a father.
What, father or father?
No, father. I'm quite happy with the way that you say
father.
Father wolf.
Nah, I mean, I'm going to co-sign what everybody else said, but I don't think that I'll be as hard or as harsh as my brother Webbs. If I have earned my hard-earned cash, I'm thinking about what my son is going to have in my absence. I'm assuming that I'm not there. Is that the assumption?
Let's if that's what works in your head, because you would buy a gift.
Because I would do it myself.
It could be a case that she don't have any money and he's giving her that money. I bought you a gift already. You don't have any money, so I'm going to give you some money to buy a gift.
If the man is giving that amount of money to the woman to buy him or her a Christmas gift, then he's obviously paying child support as well. So he's given her money to support the child already, and then this is extra funds for something special, a special occasion. So don't use the money that I've earned for this special occasion to pay for the other kids.
Okay, but just going off what you just said there, let's say that he does pay child support and the rest of the children, I mean, the rest of the children's fathers doesn't. So would you then push that same thing on to say, look, only use my money to buy food for my child and not buy food for the other?
Mm-hmm. I'll answer that. Stavros will say no, because that's a different thing. This child support thing, for me, is like, it's a law thing, isn't it? I don't see, like, providing for my child as child support. I know it's the same words used in a different way around, but it's just different. Child support for me just sounds like the government has told you you must give X, Y, Z to this woman because you've had a child with her. Whereas I have no problem providing for my child and that's giving right. and doing things for myself. So if I have to give her X, Y, Z, if it's £250 a week, then she gets £250 a week, and end of the day, as far as I'm concerned in my head, that's not child support. That's money I just that's have to give this money, woman. Yeah, yeah, whatever she has to do with it is whatever she's going to do.
Well, what I've got to say is this, is that if you are with a woman who has got two kids from another relationship or from two other relationships, surely you would be encouraging her to get child support or some kind of financial support from the other two fathers.
You could do, but there's some people that don't want the other fathers involved and will be quite happy to just pay for the child never to see the dad again.
Oh yeah, personally,
I would encourage it because that puts more of a burden on the person that is actually there.
Okay, what if the woman was in an abusive relationship with one of these, or let's say it's one man, two children from the same man, it was abusive, she'd just rather not have them in her life. Because if you don't need them in your life. Yeah, but if I force him to give me the money, it's like he's coming back into my life. He's gonna come back.
Boy, I would still encourage it, man. Okay. Fuck that. See, you get me? Get the money that your children deserve to have. No, you get me?
That's your job.
Hang on, Webbs is angling to say something.
No, that's not my job.
Yeah, I've got it, man. I don't know. I might be stepping on what Wahala has to say here. But a question leading on from this question to all of the brothers in the room. Would you be comfortable bringing up another man's child? If your child is in this relationship with this woman, but there's two other kids, and you're the sole provider for these two other kids, are you going to be comfortable with that?
I would have got out of a woman with kids in the first place. That's just me, because I don't want to be involved in a situation where I've got a third party involved in my relationship. That's my personal opinion. But if I'm already in that relationship, then I'll look after the kids the same way that I'll look after mine in certain capacities. But I'm going to let you answer, but there's another question. When the next question popped up, I was like, boy, I can't really say to myself that I think all kids are equal in this situation, because they're not. But I'll give you that.
Don't forget it, you know.
I'm not going to forget. I know it very well. But yeah, in this situation, I will try to look after the kids the same way I would. But if I'm very strange with this one, because people have asked me this question before and I said certain things and people look at me like, that's crazy. Like I said, that if... Okay, let's say that me and Simple ended up having children with the same woman, yeah?
God forbid bad things.
But it happened, yeah? Right? Simple's gone and I'm still there, yeah? So when is the time...
Because you're a dreadlock. Continue.
When it was... when it's time, yeah, for something like the kid to have trainers or whatever... I wouldn't buy that kid any trainers. I would say that is for their dad to come and do. If they was asking me for this, that and the other, I wouldn't do it. I would say, if their dad's involved in their life, I wouldn't do it.
Okay.
I would say that is for their father to do it. And people are like, how can you be like that? And no. I was like, it's not a bad thing.
Common sense.
It's not even common sense. It's like, that's their father. I'm not coming here to... If your father's involved in your life, I'm not coming here to replace your father. I'm just living in the house with your mum at the time, innit? This is your father. So these are things that you would ask your father to do. If he's not comfortable doing those things, why am I going out of my way to do that, in one? And two...
So hold on, if he's not comfortable doing it, then you're still not going
to
do it?
If he says to this child, I don't want you to have this, why am I going out
to... Oh, you mean he doesn't want them to have... Okay, a certain...
Yeah, a certain thing. Okay. But if it's a case where he doesn't have the money to do certain things, again, I would have to address it in my head whether or not I want to then go and get this child the things that his father can't provide. I don't know. But if your father's there and your father's involved in your life, then he should do the things that I think are fatherly duties. I'll look after my house, but you look after your child. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And it is common sense to me.
But a lot of people don't see it like that.
I would always, if I was in a relationship where I was with a woman who had a child that wasn't my own, which is another guy's child, and if the man was still in the life of that child, then I would not want to step on his toes.
And that's what I wouldn't do.
And to do certain things like taking him to the barbershop or, you know, or buying him this and that. If If I put it this way, if I was a man who had a child, I do have a son, and his mum got into a relationship, I would make sure that I'm doing everything that I need to do as a father for my son. And I wouldn't want another man to come in and step on my toes and do the things that I'm already doing. If the in the event that
you were unable to
I'm not doing these things and I'm what these women refer to as a waste man.
Waste man star.
Then I ain't got no ground to really
No legs to stand on.
Okay, what if you're not a waste man, you're just in a situation where you're working, let's say hand to mouth? No, it's just hand to mouth. You get X amount and you have to spend all that X amount in trying to better yourself for your children. So Is it hand to mouth or foot to mouth?
What hand
is
to mouth? No, it's
hand
fine.
Hand to mouth. Yeah.
Nobody's laughing at that. Go on.
All right. And so.
You said foot to mouth. Foot to mouth. You know.
So, what happens is basically your child wants £100 pair of trainers. Mm-hmm. Now, if you could afford that, you would get it. You don't think, as much as you know they're expensive, you don't think my child should not have it. So, it's not an issue of they're too expensive. No child should have £100 pair of trainers. I'm not getting it for them. Okay. It's just that I can't afford to get you them right now. Because I have bills to pay. Yeah? Okay. I have to give your mother child support or extra. But the dude that she's with gets them. You know you could save £25 a month and in 4 months' time I can get you them trainers. But they just get it now.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say, I understand because I can't do it for my child right now? Or would you say, no, let the child wait and let me do it because that's
what you know what I try to do in situations, in most situations that can cause conflict? I always try to empathize, you know. I always try to put myself in the other person's shoes. So then I would switch it and put myself in a situation where I am the person who is who has this stepson who wants a pair of trainers that his father said that he'll get him at a later date. Would I do it? I wouldn't, because to me that's taking the piss and it's stepping on a guy's toes.
This is what I'm saying.
So what I would do, in the event that my ex has now got a man, we have to have a conversation. And there has to be certain ground rules, there has to be certain housekeeping rules that have to be set.
So,
and I'm not in that situation now, and it may come.
But what you have then is potentially children in a home where one gets, not whatever they want, but within reason, all the things they want, and the other one just has to sit there and wait.
Well, that's
and,
how it goes.
And watch the sibling, their half brother or half sister, just get everything because I could get it for you, but your dad's getting it for you. And not in a bad way.
Mm.
It's just that I'm not depriving my child because I'm waiting for another man, as much as I understand his plight and his situation. So I have to deal with my child. So I could deal with your child, but you don't want me to. So then are you happy for everybody on the table? Is like, would you be happy for your child just to go without? And I know none of us are in this situation, but if you were, would you be happy with your child going without or waiting that much longer whilst their sibling, their actual half-brother, sister that they live in a house with, is just getting what they want?
I won't be happy with someone stepping on my toes.
Simple Simon, I probably wouldn't.
You might have to swallow your pride.
That man's answered the question.
I probably wouldn't
be happy with it, but that doesn't stop that being what necessarily has to happen at that time.
It doesn't have to happen. It's a choice that you're making.
No, I would still make the choice, but I wouldn't be happy that I have to make the choice.
Okay, cool.
Which choice would you make?
What, that they'd have to wait till I'm getting it for them.
That's it.
So that's two. That's two. Webs, what would you do?
Man, that's my man.
What would you do in that situation?
No, it's the same as Simple said. They'd have to wait till I can get it for them. But they would know that when I get it for them, your half brother's trainers or whatever is mash up and beat up. Yours is fresh and clean.
And if you look at they're fresh and clean, but they're out of fashion now. Nobody wears them.
But wait, okay. So then here's another scenario. Well, not another scenario, but within the same thing we're talking about.
Yes.
You could go as far as to say, like, there's ways around this, isn't it? Like, this would require a great deal of swallowing of pride, but you could speak to the other father and say to him, okay, you're going to buy your children this. I was going to buy my children this or my child that. you buy it and I'll give you the money back.
Yeah, that's the way you can get around it.
That's the way you can get around. So from the children's point of view, all the children receive the thing at the same time. They don't know what's going on. And it then becomes between your pride and the other man's pride.
Let me touch on something on this. Right, there's two things I want to say. This is like the reason why you're saying what you're saying is the reason why I would just wouldn't go out with women with kids.
Who's saying what they're saying?
Mr. Wolf. AKA Yemi. The reason why I'm saying that I wouldn't deal with a woman with kids is because I have, especially a woman whose the child's father is highly involved in the situation, is because I've got too much respect for fatherhood to be involved in that situation. Because I know full well that I'm the type of man that wants to do what I'm doing all the time. Yeah, so I think everybody on the table will be able to tell you if Wahala wants to do something, that's what he's doing. I think we can all agree that that's the type of person that I am. I'm very stubborn. If that's what I want to do, I'm doing it. And I don't think I can be that way with somebody else's child. So I always put myself in the scenario where I think to myself, let's say that I was living with this woman, everybody's cool, and then I get a job offer to go abroad, and it's the best job offer I've ever got in my life. And I'm going to have to say, look, we're going to all have to go abroad. Then what happens to that man's child? I'm going to have to be telling this man, I'm taking your child somewhere, because the mum doesn't want to leave the child, and the mum's not prepared to leave. I can't do that because I would respect him more and end up leaving up the job because I don't want this man to leave his child. Mm-hmm. Do you understand? So that's why I said I don't get involved. Mm-hmm. But there is a scenario where I said, and this is the scenario where it is. All right, so you've got two kids in the house. You might remember this scenario. It's a very old school one, but I always love this question, right? Bring up the Dear Rob, because Dr. Rob is the one that brought this question to the table one time, long time ago, right? You've got two kids in the house, right? You are the father that doesn't live with the children, right? So you're the that doesn't live with the child. They've got a stepdad now, blah blah blah. You have saved up all your money to take your child to private school, right? You've got enough money to send your child to private school, and you want your child to go to private school.
Hold on, you're saying one child is yours, one isn't.
One is not your child. Okay. Yes. One is the child of the person that lives with them.
All right.
You are saying to the mother, I'm going to send my child to private school because I've saved up this 100 grand a year that I've got to pay for it, or blah, blah, blah. And I'm sending my child to private school. They then say no, because they can't afford to send the other one to private school and they don't want one to feel left out. How would you deal with this situation?
Send your child to private school.
Yeah, but you can't just send your child to private school because I'm assuming legally she's got more rights than you under this situation.
So then you take her to court and say, I want to send my child to private school. She don't want to send the child to private school because of a child that she's had with another relationship.
You spend all the money on lawyers. After you win, you can't even afford to take her to private school again.
Deprive my child of an education?
That's what it is. It's just depravity.
And if you was the other way around and you was the other father, would you tell them to send the child to private school?
Yeah, I would.
I don't see anything wrong with that, but there was when this debate was going on, a lot of especially women were saying, "No, you can't why? Separate them." Why? You know what? I noticed
separate.
You know what I noticed, and I knew why it is. Almost every African that came onto that post, or any African descent, was like, "I'm sending my child to private school. Send the child to private school."
One time,
because they know that even if the child was by the same mother and father, if one of them is smart enough to go to private school and the other one is not smart enough to go, they're not going to hold the other one back because of this one that's dumb. Mm-hmm. So they're sending that child to private school.
Already, this one that is dumb.
It's already, that's in their own house. Mm. Like it sounds like even me. I brought up the fact that in my house, this has got nothing to do with smart or dumb. But my oldest brother and sister went to boarding school.
Mm.
Obviously, that's a me and Stav went to whatever normal state school, state school, whatever. Yeah. So there's already a difference in the different type of learning that you get, because obviously boarding schools are meant to be more, you know, corporate.
They got better education.
They get better education than blatantly. Exactly. Yeah. Whereas we got less education because that's what they had at the time. But I don't see anything wrong with that. I'm not going to go and question that going forward.
Hence Wahala's demeanor.
But other people going forward are thinking that you can't separate the two children. How is one child going to feel and how is the other? But I'm thinking, I'll save that money to send my child to private school.
The way I broke that down in my head when you were saying it, I was thinking to myself, well, let's just say it's not private school and state school. Let's say it's one child is proficient in music and the other child isn't proficient in music, and one child can go to a music school and the other child can't go to the music school because they're not good enough to get into the music school.
do you stop the child who's good at music from going to that school because the other child really wants to go to music school but they're not good enough? No, you don't. You send the music child to the music school and the other child has to find something else that they're better at. That's it.
Not even that. Web's here. If that's a good upbringing and a good background, the child that goes to music school comes back and teaches the dumb child that can't play the
instrument. Why does the child have to be dumb? Sorry.
The painted one.
No, I don't know. I just think
it will teach that child how to play.
I think there's a lot of things. Going back even to the present thing, there's a lot of things in this situation, but you just got to just... Sometimes you just got to either eat your ego or you just have to stand by what you stand by.
Mr. Wolf is saying that if I am the stepfather in this situation, I would allow that stepchild with no problems to go to the private school. And if my other child is not, if we haven't got the funds to take him to private school, then it's public state school. It's no big thing.
Would that make you feel less of a man?
No. Not at all.
You just get private tutors, isn't it? You make up for the difference.
Yeah. Well, you might not be able
there
to
is,
that.
There is true. A different type of education that the private schools offer, but if the money's not there, the money's not there. If this man has got money to send his child to private school, then send
I always say that. If you it don't matter where you send your child, if they don't want to learn, they don't want to learn.
Yeah, it's true. And vice versa.
Mr.
Wolf mentioned something about being empathetic in these situations and putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. We all spoke here from a male perspective. What about the idea from a female perspective? I know we're not female, we've never been female, but Webs. can we kind of...
I've been in females.
Jesus. Can we look at it from the female perspective to say, like, you have two children that you love?
Well, this last situation that Wilder just brought up.
No, I'm talking about the original question.
The present.
Yeah, about the present.
You can't, as the woman, there's no way you're going to go and say to myself, chat, I'm buying this kid Xbox S1 or whatever. And I'm buying the other two, there's controllers. That's probably the smartest thing to do, actually.
Yeah.
That's probably the smartest thing to do. Because it makes it like it's all of them. But you know what I mean? This is the controller. But what do I plug it into? You plug it into the air. Until we can afford it. Ask your daddy where you can plug it into. Ask your damn daddy where you can plug it into. Damn.
You know what?
The right thing to do is for the woman to ask the guy if she can use some of that money.
Yes, which is what she should
have done. Spend on the
other kids. Which she should have done. And I don't think that's a big problem for her to even say that. If he then says no... Then he says no, but at least you've asked that question and you've done the thing.
And then you can be smart and skirt around it and then buy what? Something. Then you can be smart, skirt around it, because women are women and sometimes they do what they want. So for me...
Not sometimes, all the time.
Listen, I would, if I was a woman, I would buy like a console.
If I was a girl...
And I would buy them like a Xbox or a PlayStation. That way you could say, I've bought your son this. But then in reality, they all complain.
Yeah, but that child will be telling another child. So my daddy bought this, is mine.
Hold on, what you're saying is that you want, all right, I give a woman £500, buy something for my child. Oh, Stavros, I don't have the money. You know the other children's dad are not providing. Can I use this £500 and spread it amongst the three of them and get them all something? No, dear. I want this to be just for my child, yeah? So that's that. End of discussion.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So me as a woman now, I go, let me think. How can I work my way around this? I buy an Xbox, give it to all the children.
No, and give it to one.
That's what I'm saying. You already started that problem already.
You've given it to one.
It's mine now.
All can use
ain't
it.
Mine.
Yeah, but so you got to remember, as a parent, you have the meaning of the house. Forget what the child says.
Hold on.
Sorry, go on.
Ain't mine.
You wrap up one Christmas gift under the tree and just give it to one child.
Yes.
I just say, look, it's mine.
Okay, Webs.
No, I was. I got like, you actually saying that, and you're just being mean.
No, he's trying to say they should share it. Well,
yeah, but just say this is the present for the house, so it belongs to everybody.
The right thing that the woman should do is give the money back to the dad and say, sorry, if I cannot use this money to spend the money on all the other kids, I prefer you take... I'm saying this. If I cannot use the money to spend it with all the other kids, I prefer you take back the money and go and buy the child the gift yourself. And you give the child the gift. Don't ask me to give the gift to the child. Don't tell me to do your dirty work, because you're telling me that I now have to go in front of my child and give him a present and then look at the other children hand to mouth looking like Oliver.
Good answer.
I believe that is the correct answer.
That is the correct
answer. So you should take the money back and deal with it. If he then says to me, child, I'm taking the money back and I'm going to do that, then that's fine. If he I'm assuming that any other man, like me, I know, if the woman said that to me, I'll be like, all right, child, all right, give him a £10 out of the thing. No, obviously, I'll say to give, get them something, or I'll give them extra. If it's £500, I particularly want to give this child, then I'll find, if I've got extra money, I'll give them extra money and say, look, can you buy so-and-so this as well? Yeah? So I would do that. But I think she needs to then put the onus on that father to come back and do what he wants that woman to do, which is to basically just shun the other children with the presence that they've got and present something else.
Sorry, quick question. Same dynamic, but just slightly different, yeah? If you're the godparent of a child and that...
Godparent?
You're the godparent. You're the child's godparent.
Mm.
And that child has siblings.
Mm.
And you want to buy the child something as their godparent. Do you have to buy something for the siblings as well?
I don't buy the godchild to print up.
I do. I got godchildren. I buy them presents. And I don't see this as being an issue.
So you buy it for the other children as well?
No. Why?
Okay.
They've got their own godparent, no?
Okay, keep
going.
They
should be.
Okay.
I've got godchildren. I don't even know which ones they are anymore. One of them is my nephew, so I'll buy him anyway. So that's a different thing.
Which one?
Lawrence. We're both godparents. Lawrence. Okay.
Progress.
It was, you know, making sure that they hedge their bets just in case there's a car crash or one of us goes in it. But I think, for me, in that situation, they all got godparents, isn't it? So they can get somebody to pay for that.
Okay.
But I have no issue with that.
I was going to end it on what I thought was the best note, which is Wala's answer to what he would do if he was the woman in that situation, which he usually is. So, and I was just going to end it there and give out the socials and say goodbye to everyone. So we are wrapping up the first episode of season two of Eloquently Saying Nothing. I think it went well. It's been good to be around the boys. I'm Stavros. You can catch me at Stavros Boss, everything. That's Twitter and all the other things, malarkeys. Guys, you want to say goodbyes?
I'm on the way to Winterfell. It's Jon Snow.
The dead Jon's all good, boy.
Can you not?
Of the black. Well, hello.
Spoil these things for me, please.
Well, hello is saying laters. You can catch me on Twitter at Big Wahala. I don't have any of them other things, you know. I haven't got Insta and all that blarky.
That's cool.
But yeah, you can catch us all at that at ESN podcast. Everything as well, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, catch me at Big Wahala on Twitter. I'm there sometimes, isn't it?
Simple Simon, you do Simple Simon FB, and you're sure to find me on the Twitterverse. That is correct. I'm quiet at the moment, but I do have my periods and seasons where
I do
my 140 character smash Bible bars hashtag.
This is Mr. Wolf, aka Yemi. You can catch me on Twitter, not that active at the moment, but I will be from now on. It's Yemi Online. Instagram, Yemi's Insta, and I think that's about it for now.
What's going on? It's your boy from Sunrise. It's the actor on Instagram and Twitter. Sunset DJ Webslinger on Twitter.
Ooh,
yeah. I know what his socials are. That still confused me, but anyway. all right. Also, you can subscribe and rate to the podcast on all your podcasters. So that's iTunes and Stitcher. Everywhere else you get your podcasts, find us there on Google Play and everything and whatnot. So rate, subscribe, download. Bring us up the ratings, please. We're black and we need your help. We need your help.
Obama ain't no battle no more.
Also, you can follow us on all the social network links that you can find at ESN Podcast, at ESN Podcast. That's everywhere but Facebook, would you believe it? Because some bastard already has taken ESN / ESN Podcast. So we don't have a Facebook yet. We'll have one and I'll probably give it to you next week or the week after or whenever I decide to make one. That's it. So thank you and we are out.
And remember, people, if you ain't saying nothing, say it well.
Ladies.
Happy New Year, people.
So what do you think? Must be hungry. Webs, man, why do you want to be doing this? Every time you want to be doing this.
I have.